looks like everyone is just about there. Again, Psalm 118 reads, verse 1, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His faithful love endures forever. Let the congregation of Israel repeat, his faithful love endures forever. Let Aaron's descendants, the priests, repeat, his faithful love endures forever. And we'll finish with verse 4. All who fear the Lord repeat, his faithful love endures forever. Amen. Lord, we just magnify your holy name tonight, Lord. We invite you into this place, Lord, this place called grace. We ask that you come into our minds and our souls and our hearts as we worship you and praise you. We ask that we have a word tonight from you. So we ask that you bless our pastor, Heavenly Father, that you will get all the glory for it all. For we know that your faithful love endures forever. We will always repeat, your faithful love will endure forever. When we cannot see anything in front of us, we will remind ourselves that your faithful love endures forever. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. We ask that you have your way tonight as we worship you in spirit and in truth. Forgive us, Heavenly Father, as we come before you with humble hearts, waiting for miracles, signs, and wonders that you can give us, Lord. We're anticipating those things tonight, Lord. Welcome in this place. We pray all this in Jesus' holy name. Amen, amen, amen.
Hallelujah. Let's keep praising him. How's everybody doing tonight? Let's just bless the Lord, all of our soul and all that's within us. Let's bless his holy name. Amen. Amen. He's an awesome God, and he is worthy of all the praise. I have praise on my mouth for my sister Melody. I got praise on my mouth for my husband Robert. I got praise in my heart for Bill Carmel. I got praise on my heart for our choir, our praise team. I got praise. Hallelujah. I got praise on my heart for sister Jasmine. Hallelujah. I got praise on my heart. Hallelujah. Let's lift up the Lord, God. Let's lift him up. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's lift up the Lord.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross. I was dead, you paid from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Let's sing it, y'all. Come on.
Lord, I lift your name on high.
Don't you love to sing his praises?
From the
Greatness of your power, the exceeding greatness of your power, the exceeding greatness Time in our worship service where we will render unto God a portion of what he has blessed us with. Amen. It is our offering time. Amen. Amen. Glory and hallelujah. Let me read the scripture here. 2 Corinthians, the 9th chapter, and the 6th verse. But this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly. And he which soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Every man, according as he has purpose in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loveth the cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that ye, always having sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. God will take care of you. God will take care of you. Bless the Lord as the Lord has blessed you. Give unto the Lord as he has given unto you. And when you give, don't give sparingly or grudgingly or of necessity. Give from your heart, because God has given you everything that he could give you. He gave your life and your body, air in your lungs, a smile to sing, a voice to talk. And God wants you to give as he has prospered you, according in your heart. And God is able. He's able to make everything abound unto you when you give. Now, let me tell you this. Giving is not a, God is not a slot machine. He's not a lotto ticket. He's not a scratch-off. When you scratch it off, you know, you pay a dollar, you get some money. God is not looking to bless you in that respect. So don't come that way with God, thinking if I'm going to get $10, he's going to give me $20. No, he's not going to bless you like that. He might, and he may not, but he's going to bless you more than what you need. He's going to give you the blessing that you stand in need of. He's going to give you the blessing that you stand in need of. And sometimes that's not necessarily money. You may need something else. You may need your health and your strength. You may need a phone call. You may need prayer. And God sends somebody your way. God blesses you according to your lifestyle and according to what you give unto him. So let us give. And let us give wholeheartedly unto the Lord as he has given unto us. Amen. So let us pray. Father God in heaven, we come to you, lift up your offering. And we come to ask your blessing upon the offering, Lord. Bless those who are going to give and those who have a desire to give and have not. It may be used for the building of your kingdom. We give you glory, we give you honor, and we give you praise and your blessing, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray, and for his sake, amen. Grace Bible Fellowship, it's time to give to the your tithes and offering and to the dream offering. Hallelujah. All right, let's give. Everybody laugh and come give some. Put some in the basket.
Yeah. not going there, y'all. However, I got a little testimony, and it's only going to take a couple minutes. Amen. Less than a couple months ago, I stood in front of everybody for offering, right? I talked about being faithful, amen, and having something in your spiritual bank account, amen. Well, I just got news today that I got a job. Thank you, Lord. But listen, Linda. It's not only a job, but it's a ministry. Amen. It's a career. What I'm going to be doing is I'm going to be a sales director at a 55-plus brand new, it's like a resort, y'all, senior living facility. Amen. It's brand new. It has a concierge that's there 24/7, so it's like a resort. It's beautiful. Do you hear me? It's beautiful. And one of the things I told the Lord that I wanted is to work with seniors. I wanted to work with seniors. And you know what? When you're faithful, y'all, when you're faithful, and when you love the Lord, He will give you the desires of your heart. Now let me just preface this. I'm just gonna put a little italics right here. I haven't seen the offer letter yet, so I don't know what I'm making. So they gotta pay me what I'm worth. Amen. Amen. So I might come back next week and say, y'all, I didn't take it, but I'm believing and I'm trusting God that dollar amount's gonna be right. Amen. Amen.
Said something that y'all didn't get the last part. You didn't get the last part about what she said. She said, I got the job. She said, I haven't gotten the offer letter yet. She said, so if I come to y'all next week and tell y'all I didn't take the job, she said, I didn't take the job, not because I wasn't appreciative. She said, but I didn't take the job because everybody in here has to decide what you're worth. Because if you don't decide what you're worth, somebody else will tell you what you're worth. If you ask me right now, can I have an hour of your time, what would it cost? I can tell you. Because I put a dollar figure on what I'm worth. Now, I may do something for free, but I know what I'm worth. And that's why she said, though, you know, I'd love to do it, it's ministry. She ain't doing it for $10,000. Y'all ain't hearing me up here. Because people will devalue you if you allow them to. You tell folks sometimes, you know, don't devalue me. You know, they make you feel you're not worth this or you can't afford this. You go to a place and somebody is walking around with you. Why are you following me? They don't do that when you in them little, I don't know the name of them stores, the Newberries or whatever them little stores. Don't say the name because you're telling on yourself. But I don't know the name of them stores. It's one right by that old Antioch movie theater. They don't follow you around in there. But let you walk in Saks or in Nordstrom's or in Cartier. They walking around. What you following me for? Because they don't think you can afford it. And what they've done is devalued you before you've opened up. That's why we have to conduct ourselves a certain way. So I'm telling those kids at the school, you need to be in shirts, slacks, and shoes so that before we even walk in the gym, at least on the surface, we get at least a chance to be valued. And y'all better make up your mind, I'm worth something because Jesus died for me. So I know I'm worth, y'all ain't hearing me, I know I'm worth a whole lot. If the Son of God and the Son of Man gave his life for me, I got to be worth more than y'all even give me credit for. So tonight we're gonna look and if I can for one more week, if I can borrow the young kids or the young teens, you don't want to be called no kids. But then when you're old, you don't want to be called old. Amen. Mr. Mel said she worked with 55, wanted to work with 55-year-olds. I said, look around. That's all that's up ahead. But you know, everybody want to be young when you're old, and when you young, you want to be old. How old are you? 15 and a half? How old are you? 14 and three quarters? But when you're old, you be like, oh, gee, I'm 60. Well, I mean, I'm in my 60s. You don't even want nobody to know. This is, I'm in my 60s. But we were, yeah, 50 plus. I'm in the 50 plus club. You 72. What do you mean you're in the 50 plus club? You in the 50 plus, 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 plus. But I want to talk about the digital age. I want to start off by getting some thoughts from y'all, so some of the ministers, deacons, or even anybody close to a mic can help me. Last week in our teaching, we were teaching about the wiles and the manipulation and the enticement of, you know, the James 1 that says that the enemy, what he does is he entices us with sin, and it says that sin entices, and that's what cheese and the, if you just had a rat trap, the rat ain't coming. Or if you just had a pole with a hook, the fish ain't coming. It's the anchovies or the bait. Or it's that fake worm. What's that fake worm called? That fake one. The lure. That looked like he moving in the water. He wiggling, looked like he a good meal. But he's really a trap. That cheese, that peanut butter, it's really a trap. That cute girl that say you just the best thing at the office, it's a trap. And what the enemy uses is he uses things you like. Because James 1 says that he will entice you with sin. And with sin, when it's full birth or it gives birth to death, when sin is mature in its totality of your life, it gives birth to death. I don't remember the movie. I think it was called like Temptations or something, one of the movies with Tyler Perry, and it was a young couple and they were in love, and then this man began enticing that lady with material stuff that her husband couldn't do. Husband had a dream and a vision from God. They were children of God, and she took her eye off God, took her eye off her husband. She started putting her eye on that man and the stuff, and he got her caught up, and then she ended up contracting HIV, and then that man, his dream came true, and he was a farm, ran, owned a pharmacy, and found success in his life. And she really wished she could have gotten it back. But once he moved forward, he was looking backwards. Somebody need to hear what I just said. You better make up your mind. Anybody that's not moving and progressing the way you're going, all they can do is hold you back. They can't take you forward. And anybody that says that God is not the way, or you're doing too much church, or why are you going to Bible study, or why you be praying, or why you doing, they don't understand that you are positioning yourself for greatness. So you need to remove yourself, or they will keep you stagnated, i.e. they'll keep you stuck. And we were talking last week, and we were talking about how, whether you want to agree with it or not, over this last 168 hours of me kind of breaking up with my phone. I wish somebody was hearing me. Me and my phone, just, we didn't got the same relationship we had a week ago, a couple weeks. Our relationship is getting bad. I wish somebody understood relationship. It's not what it used to be. And we kind of painted a picture last week, and we asked the question, do you feel that your phone has a stronghold on you? And we said, if you don't think that, what was the word we used? If you weren't addicted to the telephone, outside of work-related and minimal, I think we gave it 7 hours or something. If you used it for more than 7 hours in the course of a week and you came back, then it would be an indication that the phone has a stronghold. You're addicted to it. You couldn't let it go. I ain't played no games, ain't watched no movies, ain't nothing. And I'm not doing that to brag. It's just I'm able at this chapter of my life, in many respects, I'm able to let stuff go. I'm just able to, something that is not good for me, I'm able to let it go. And I want to hear from you all, what was your experience like over this week of at least, because we pray for everyone, and we challenge some. Everybody didn't originally get up, but I made you get up for prayer anyway, amen? But I want to know, what young and old, what was your experience this week? As we, I think the young folk, we said 5 hours, adultery is at 7. Were you able to adhere to that time? It was 7 hours and 14 hours? Oh, well, I wouldn't even weigh less than that then. But I want to hear from you. I want to hear from somebody. Were you able to adhere to those time frames? Because it was, what, an hour a day for children or young folk and 2 hours a day for adults. Now, I don't need to hear from you if you don't spend a lot of time on the phone anyway. You know, I know some older saints, they don't spend as much time on the phone. They ain't texting and they ain't doing all that social media. You're like, Mama, let me show you this. She'd be like, I don't need to know how to do that. So it probably is not as big a challenge for her, but for some of us that are on our phones all day, every day, I want to hear from you. Go ahead.
Only because I started, even before Pastor started the study, like I joined InShape, and they said, download the app, then we'll check you in, and then you can get t-shirts, and you can get, I said, I joined the gym to get away from the phone. I didn't join the gym to have another app to chase after. So I had already been saying no. You know how you're on your phone, and you click on something to get information? All of a sudden, they start shooting you emails. You know, I clicked on my phone to find out how to become a chaplain in a hospital. And I kid you not, I get 50 emails a day just on job openings and so forth and so on. So I learned not to click, and it's kept me in the low zone. So right now, even before they ask if I want something, I won't even click on it. I won't even acknowledge it, because otherwise you just get caught up in that rat race. So I've been real good about stopping it even before it happens.
All right, anybody else? And I'd rather you come and be up here, so once one person speaks, another one can go. But I need to hear from somebody, unless y'all just said, Reverend, as soon as you prayed, I just went right back to doing what I'm doing. And that's fine. That's fine. And I'll just do what I'm doing. I'll just tell y'all what God told me to tell you. Go ahead, ma'am.
Amen. I was more conscious of scrolling, so when I have downtime, even if it's just a moment, my natural reaction is to click, scroll. Not even just anything. Email, scroll. Check something else, scroll. And so I was more conscious of not scrolling, and just if I'm in a taxi, just sit and just wait. If I'm waiting at the BART station, just sit and wait. And it was more of a conscious decision, and it made me realize how much I was just scrolling.
Okay, and that scrolling takes time. So did you adhere to your time frame, or you didn't even?
You know, I don't really use that much time anyway, because I guess if I added up piece by piece, but I don't spend a lot of, I actually don't know, because I didn't add it up piece by piece, but I don't have like Facebook or watch a lot of movies, because most of my time I'm studying. So it's just in between if I'm at the BART station or in a taxi cab, but I probably could have added that up and saw that I was being more conscious of that.
Yeah, and to be honest with you, we spend a lot more time on our phones than we think we do.
Yes.
Every now and then, just after you hang up the phone, say in the course of a day, just click on all the calls and just look and see how many minutes you spend on the phone. You'll be like, man, I know I was on the phone 2 hours today. Because you 10 minutes here, 6 here, 2 here, 32 here, you know, 47 with your mama or your husband. And then you realize, or your job, you know, and all those calls weren't necessary. Go ahead, sis.
I have noticed a change in two areas. One, I left my phone at home. I said, oh, well, it's at home. It'll be there when I got back. Normally, now I don't work that far, but I will drive all the way home to get my phone. So I didn't even worry about it, didn't worry about who's calling, didn't even try to call my voicemail to see who's been calling. It was just there, and it would wait till I get back home. The other area, I don't use a whole lot of time, but what I also have found that sometimes when I make a phone call, that's the only call I want to make, but then another call comes in, those scam calls. And so I had found myself before answering the phone thinking it's someone for me. But I start just not even answering it. If it's for me, they'll leave me a message.
Did you go over your time this week? Or
no, I wanted to add up more time to try to make that goal. But I found that I used less time because it didn't matter to me that I didn't have my phone with me.
Okay, and the folk who do use it, obviously, don't want to talk right now. But I want to say a couple things, y'all. If you're the type that, if say you call somebody, or say you have that dead time that Reverend Michelle was talking about, you ever go, who could I call? And then you just looking in your address book and just going like that? Because you don't want dead time. You don't want no idle time. It's not that the Lord told you to call Mary and you got to find Mary's number. It's that it's nothing to do. Or have you ever been in the car with somebody and somebody's phone rang? You be like, is that my phone? That ain't your phone. But you want it to be. Because in your subconscious, y'all don't want to be real in here. In your subconscious, it's hard for you to deal with silence. Because the phone has achieved what it wanted to. Go ahead, sir.
Amen.
You know, prior to this, I really wasn't that heavy on phones, using the phone. But starting about October, I started finding myself, before you even came with this lesson, started finding myself really using the phone because I was doing some networking. You know, I'm hooked up with a few brothers that do Christian networking. So I was doing networking, trying to network this project that I'm on right now. And I just found myself just, man, just on the phone. And you came with this message. And like I said, prior before, a phone wasn't really no issue to me, just making calls. I don't even use apps. I just make calls. And I sent you an email a couple of years ago, and it came, when you brought this lesson, it came back to me. This group called Steel Pulse, and they came out with a song called Earth Crises back in 1984. And they pulled a verse of the lyric from Uncle Paul. Uncle Paul, they said, doctrines of the fallen angel, no water shall quench eternal flames of hell, hellfire. And then the last part of the verse that coincides to what you said, he said, your life in your hands just waiting to explode. Touch every button, fingertip control. This was back in 1984. And that song came to me, your life in your hands just waiting to explode. Touch every button, fingertip control. And when you came with that message, it brought it all back. I was like, wow, thank you, Holy Ghost. That was 1984 on up to present. Those devices, man, they can get you. So thank you for the message. And it just brought back all that to let us know it's relevant and it's straight from the Holy Spirit.
And let me say this. Thank you. Let me say this. I'm not anti-phone. I'm not trying to get us to throw phones away the way I would like us to throw away some credit cards, some time, a crack pipe. Come on, somebody. You know, some condoms and you ain't married. You know, them little bottles, what they call, Brother Milton? Them little bottles. Partials. Personals. Okay. All right. Thank you, Brother Milton. Personals. You know, we're throwing that kind of stuff away. There's divine purpose. But I want you to understand, that the phone is not as good a friend of yours as you think. As you think. Go ahead, mm-hmm. Sis.
The area that I'd like to speak to is when you spoke about when you're in your time with God and things come up. I normally answer everything. He answers nothing. I answer everything. So what happened with me, because what you said was, when you answer these bullets that come through, you go back to your study and you're not the same. So I was able to experience that. I did answer it, and I said, let me see if I go back to my study and if I be the same. I wasn't the same. I wasn't that far off, but just a little off was enough off.
Absolutely.
You know, so I thank God for that, because God has a whole lot that he wants to say to us, especially now. I'll just say this one little thing. I was studying one time, and I'm starting to gain weight, and I don't want to. And I started to study the Word of God. When I got done studying, I wanted a spinach salad. Before I started studying, I wanted a hamburger with some bacon on it. Okay, so I'm just saying, if it doesn't even matter what you read, it'll change you. You know, so I'm not going to give my thought process to a bullet that comes through, or someone's trying to call me, someone, because your text has come through. My Bible app is on the phone. My devotions are on the phone. So I'm looking at my phone, but I'm using it for positive reasons. So if I don't click off things that don't matter, I can stay who I am to God at that time and in my worship. Amen?
And let me say this before this young lady speaks. My question in the spirit has already been answered, because everybody talking don't even spend a lot of time with apps, and apps are what absorb all your time. These are in the digital game. These old folkies. These old folkies. Ain't no Instagram, you know, Facebook, LinkedIn. You know, ain't no BET, Apple Movies. These folk that I don't even use it. So the ones who do, who are all of y'all, most of you all, you're already answering my question. One, you couldn't stop.
Right.
And two, you didn't want to try.
Right.
Which tells me that phone, with all due respect, is beginning to become your master. Because I would have thought you'd have got up and said, hey man, I tried, I could. Y'all ain't even saying nothing.
Right.
Y'all just sitting there kind of like, what they gonna say? But you need to be real about the experiment, especially if you didn't even try. Because don't tell me you forgot. You didn't forget, because the Holy Spirit, if you saved, he wouldn't have let you forget. And I don't know why I'm pointing over there. He wouldn't have let you forget. He wouldn't have let you forget. I'm talking about people that are consumed. And I was consumed. I was consumed with the use of the phone. I probably got more Bible apps than I probably study out of the Word of God on my phone more than anybody, but it don't matter.
Right.
I got games and apps and shows and this and this and this. And I intently, specifically did everything in my power this week not to be absorbed with that phone. And some of you all could have tried, but you didn't try that hard. And I know that that phone has a stronger hold on you than you really want to acknowledge tonight. Go ahead, sis.
I think you explained everything. So I think I would say that this challenge was a bit of a success for me. So I don't know if I did it correctly, but I remember you saying 21 hours for the adults and 14 hours for the kids. So I set my timer for 14 hours, and every time I did something unwork-related on my phone, I turned on the timer, then when I got off, I turned it back, paused it, and then this went back and forth. So throughout the week, I would definitely say it was difficult for me to get on my phone because we're coming up on finals week and studying. I have sports and college apps. Just today I got a call from a college. And so So getting on my phone, definitely the thing for me was apps. From games to social media, I spent a lot of time on those. And so somehow you'll always find a way to just fit in like 30 seconds.
Absolutely.
Of getting games in when I had to be doing something else or I had to be researching. And so I would definitely say throughout this week, I touched it less and less and less because I tried to find something more tangible to do with my hands. Because the thing was me finding something to do with my hands.
Absolutely.
Was to put your hands somewhere else than on your phone.
Absolutely.
So I would put my phone downstairs on the charger. I'd put it on the piano away from me, and I would just be on my laptop. And then since I go to a school that has a lot of technology in it, it would have to bleed into my iPad as well, because my school gives me an iPad where I do my research on it. So it will bleed into that too, because you can download games and apps on the iPad, and there's just so much with the iPad that even I still don't know how to operate after 4 years of high school. Still don't know how to fully operate that iPad, but it bled into that too, me basically focusing on what I need to do. So on my timer, I have 5 hours left.
Good.
So I'm impressed with myself.
But you diligently tried to do it. Some of us tried, but it was a little hard. It's like
hard.
That guy lifting a weight, and you got the spotter. And when he lifts it, it's hard. But the spotter like, you can do it. And you like, dude, get this up off me. You shaking. He like, come on, man, we can do it. And he's not really going to grab it unless you give the effort. You gave the effort, and the Holy Ghost was your spotter. And he helped you to show yourself that you could. Where some of us just like, I can't do it. I'll get this thing off, you know. And then they pull it because they don't want things to drop on your chest. And I want to challenge those that didn't try next week to try. Thank you very much. You got the last one. Go ahead.
I'm a social media person. I got over 50 apps on my phone. So in saying that, during these lessons that when we've been talking about social media, I have been more aware of not using it. So last week I tried not to use my phone as much. And so I found that just like Sister Daniel said, it takes away from your connection and what you're doing with God. And so what I tried to do is every time I picked up my phone, I tried to redirect my conversation to talking to God. And so bringing this up is my friends have been calling me. And so they're like, you haven't been talking to me. Well, everybody's been calling me and I haven't been answering. I'm sorry. I haven't been answering my phone. But again, it's really because my focus again is talking and getting closer in with my connection with God. And so everybody wants to always reach out and call you on your phone. And so my friends were noticing that, hey, you're not calling me, and they're feeling left out or depressed. And my response to them is, well, I'm talking to God. So if you change that direction and look to talking to God, maybe you won't feel as lonely type of thing. So I'm not, you know, I'm just putting it real. I'm being out there. I'm just putting it real, you know. So for me, I found it that every time I did even get distracted, God must love the conversation he had with me. Because every time I picked up my social media, I was still redirected by a post or something that still made me put my phone down and get reconnected and talk back to God. And so I didn't try to intentionally, but the relationship that I realized I was missing with God, that urge took over and my phone started becoming.
So you did good this week.
Praise God.
Praise the Lord. And it's amazing. It's amazing. Everybody want to take you out to eat when you're trying to lose weight. Come on. You know what I mean? But everybody want to call me when I'm fasting. I ain't going to be on the phone this week. But this week when I ain't fasting, don't nobody call me. Y'all know what I'm talking about. But let's look at this thing. If you went to New York, here's my question. What would you do if you went to New York? See a play. What would you do? Go shop. Well, eat. Eat where? Don't say anywhere. Where would you eat? At some of the best restaurants. If you were in New York, what would you do? I went to New York, I went to the Apollo, I went to the Garden, I rode the subway, I went to Manhattan. I wish somebody was walking with me, because ain't none of those joints in the Bay Area. Am I right or wrong? If you went to, if you went to Paris, what would you do? I shopped. When I went to Paris, what would you do? I went to the Eiffel Tower when I was in Paris. I went to the Louvre. What would you do if you went to Paris? Eat where? At some of the best restaurants. Come on. And you know, huh? You gonna do it big. What if you went to the Bahamas or Bermuda? What you gonna do? I'm gonna be on them sandy blue beaches. Which we did. I'm going to eat some good, authentic food. I'm gonna do some water sports. We snorkeled. I'm gonna do some stuff I can't do here, cause I'm in the Bahamas, or I'm in Bermuda, or I'm in New York, or I'm in Paris. I want you to think about that for a second. What wouldn't you do? What wouldn't you do? What you normally do at home that you wouldn't do on vacation. I'm not going to Paris to sleep. I don't care if I go to bed at 10. I ain't going to bed at 10 in Paris. But find something to do. I don't care if I'm walking around the hotel. Tell me what y'all doing tonight. That's on a cruise ship. Anybody been on a cruise ship? Everybody be asleep. You be walking around the ship looking for some food. You just looking for something. You don't want to go to sleep. I mean, you're going to rest a little bit, but I didn't go on a cruise to go to sleep. I didn't go on a cruise to eat a hot dog. Y'all ain't getting it. I'm going to do something different than I'm accustomed to doing because I'm somewhere different. What the phone has done for us, it It has mesmerized us, and we are doing the same thing. I'm on Instagram. I'm on Snapchat. I'm on Facebook every day. I ain't talking about me. You know, I'm looking to see what such and such posts, what she's saying now. The same thing. When I serve a God whose mercies are fresh and new each and every day, he can drop new rhema words, new revelation, new understanding, new purpose, new destiny. He can give me new visions. But I don't spend that time with him. I'm spending time with people that give me the same old, same old. Since I'm talking about how great her husband is, you know he ain't as great as she's saying, but you ain't gonna tell her. Come on now. Or you hear such and such complain. Or you hear that such and such dunked on somebody, or such and such almost had a fight, or it's traffic here, or cars flipped over here, or it's an earthquake here, or it's a tsunami here, or, you know, such and such is now doing this in the impeachment proceedings. Either get rid of him or keep him. I don't really care. I don't want to hear the same thing every day. It's the same thing. Somebody got shot. The car flipped over. It's power outages, job layoffs. They're building something. They're fighting and protesting about this. But can't nobody tell me when you spend real intimate time with God that God give you the same old, same old. If you tell me that, you ain't spending intimate time with God. Because God is dropping new word, new. He is dropping new insights, new understanding when you spend time with him. Truth is, we're slaves to our mobile devices, and we don't open ourselves up to new experiences and new horizons and new revelations. And when it deals with the media and the technology, we oftentimes struggle with the word in this chapter I'm reading is FOMO. Capital F, small O, M, capital M, O, fear of missing out. It is a social disorder, a social psychological disorder that I begin to struggle when I'm not on my phone. I'm be looking for where my phone at. What I do with my phone? You got my phone? Don't be taking my phone. I'm feeling like I'm missing out on something. That's why sometimes I could be driving or stopped at a light and I got to grab my phone. Not that it rung, but I got to look at it real quick to see that anybody call me in 32 seconds from the last time I touched it. If you can't say ouch or you can't say man, at least nod your head, at least shake, give me some withdrawals, show me something. Because I feel like I'm missing out on something. It's triggered when we feel we can't afford to miss out on anything pertaining to our phones, our computers, our social networks, and our lives. Our lives have been empowered now with the advent of social media. I'm somebody now because y'all just don't know how many friends I got. I jokingly call my wife a Facebook diva. She be like, thank you. It ain't a compliment. Ain't a compliment. But we all of a sudden start feeling we're somebody because people like you. People like you because they're trying to bump up their numbers. Come on, y'all. They're trying to bump up their numbers because, you know, there's you know, kids will tell me about this dude. He got 100,000. He got 1 million followers. And the more followers you have, doors open up for you with advertisers and all kind of things. So it can behoove you, if that's the way you're rolling and that's how you get out, it can behoove you to become a diva in social media. But our lives are empowered by social media to the extent not only can we not do without our phones, but the truth is we can't do without anything anymore that has become our master. And the sad or the irony is that as much as we say that we're children of God, Jesus has never become our master. He's my savior, but he's never become my master. I say he's Lord over my life, but he's never become my master. If I don't forgive, and I don't tithe, and I don't serve, and I don't praise, even when I don't want to, he is not master over my life. Because if he's master over my life, you look at slavery, they did what Massa said to do. So here's the ironic thing when I look at it. You know, we're talking about media and we're talking about technology. And there's a spiritual parallel. We're going to talk about it in a second. But how do you know you suffer from FOMO? How do you really know that you're suffering from a fear of missing out? The first thing is, and you may want to write these down to help you. First thing is that it, the first thing you do when you get a break, you check your phone or your computer. Anybody? When you get a break? For all y'all over there looking at me like I'm speaking Chinese and you only speak English, when you get out of school, or not out of school, when you're going from passing period from one class to another as you're passing, and you may keep your books in the locker so you go get your book for the next class, but do you make sure you check your phone in the passing period? I wish I could just slap all of y'all. Just acting like I'm not talking to them. All of y'all are lying if you say you do not. I'm not talking about my mama took my phone. No, I'm talking about when you got your phone. Is there one of y'all that at school in breaks, I ain't talking about lunch, I'm talking about 5-minute passing period. Is it one of you that never check your phone during passing period? Exactly. Get on my nerves. Is it? I'm just telling the truth. You do get on my nerves. Because I'm going to tell y'all, as young people, the best thing you can do is be honest with where you are at this point in your life. Because you'll become like us. We'll be dishonest with everything we need to get right, and we act like it's not the truth. But it didn't. I didn't start acting like that stuff wasn't real at 50. I started acting like that at 12. That, she just don't like me. He just don't like me. No, they like me. That's why they saying what they saying, because they trying to help me. And there's no adult here that when you get your 15-minute break or your 30-minute or your hour lunch that you ain't looking at your phone. Anybody in here? Amen. That does not look at your phone. But you don't even have, you have a phone, man? You ain't even got a phone. What you talking about? She got two numbers in it. Mine's in my brother's. That's it. Yeah. You don't count. You're excluded. But you'll know you suffer from FOMO if the first time you get a break, you go to your phone or your computer. Number two, you experience anxiety, and you wonder, what am I missing when you can't check your phone? You ever on a plane, and for whatever reason, they're charging for Wi-Fi, you gotta pay $19, and your flight 6 hours, and you just, like, you know, and then you gotta pay for the movie, and you just, you trying to fall asleep, and you wake up, and you just like, this is a terrible flight. Ain't nothing wrong with the flight. You suffering. You're suffering from anxiety. And what did Paul say in Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 and 7? Anybody? He said, be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, make your requests known to God. Watch this. And the God of peace, which will transcend all your understanding, can give you some games to play. I wish somebody was with me. Can download some new applications in your spirit. He will transcend all your understanding, and he'll guard your hearts, and he'll guard your mind in Christ Jesus. You'll know that you suffer from FOMO when, number three, you feel edgy if you can't check your device, especially if somebody's keeping it from you. Mama, when can I get my phone? I told you can't get it till later. What time's later is when I say, you give it 30 minutes. Is it later yet, Mama? You ask me one more time, I'm not giving it to you at all. You ask your little sister, go ask Mama. You know, don't tell her I asked, but just, y'all know what I'm talking about. You get on edge. But never forget that Satan is the prince of the air. That's what Ephesians 2:2 says. And what you don't understand is everything that we celebrate technologically, a whole lot of it, it has now been infiltrated by the enemy. Let me help you see it. Years ago, we used to talk about a world system that everybody's information was going to become chip or be manifested through a chip. That's what we're using now. We're using credit cards.
that they can track every purchase. Your phone, when you have to download a new version of Apple and you act like you gotta have it, they're staying connected to you. Deacon Mike, they know everything you look at. They know everything you watch. They know every phone call you make. They can listen. You telling me about what's the organization, FDA? Man, please. They know everything you're doing. Am I right or wrong about it, y'all? You can say what you want about privacy. Hotels, bathrooms, every expense, everything you buy in the store, they know everything we do because the Prince of the Air has created it that way. The only thing they don't know, Minister Tamisha, is what's going on up in your heart. That's the only thing. They don't know what's going on in your mind. And that's why we've got to advance, young folk. You've got to advance your thinking. You've got to become a deep thinker. You've got to learn to put on the mind of Christ. To think of those things that are good and that are pure and that are holy and that are peaceable and that are gentle and entreatable. He says, think on those things. But that ain't what we think. I mean, we may read the Daily Bread in the morning. Sean, where's them little devotional books? Those words for today. Those are in the bookstore. Those are a dollar. And it should, as soon as that new month quarter comes out, them things should be swallowed up. It should be in some of y'all's backpack at school. When I get too caught up, let me pull out my devotional, my Daily Bread. Something to help center me. Because all that stuff on social media, it ain't got me centered. I was watching I forgot the name of it, but something Harlem with Bumpy Johnson, something. Don't tell me the name, because I want to be the only one unsaved here. But the last episode was over Sunday, or I watched it yesterday, or whatever it was. And I'm looking for the next episode. I need the next episode. Ain't no next episode. So all my little shows, everything is on hiatus. I'm about to lose my mind. Ain't got nothing to watch. Greenleaf ain't on right now. Y'all talk to me up in here. All my three little shows I watch, really, real talk. Season's over. And I'm like a fish out of water. When is the have and have nots coming back on? When is whatever, whatever, whatever? And you know what? It's controlling you. Whatever show, I don't know, I don't watch tons of TV, but watch this. Say the show is called, I'm dating myself, Knots Landing, Dallas, whatever. I'm excited because Friday, it's now time for the new edition of Dallas. That's when you know something got you. It's got you. Now, that's how I feel on Saturdays about Sunday. I'm excited because I can't wait till Sunday morning. I can't wait to go to church. I know I can't get amen from all y'all because some of y'all, oh, God, it's almost Sunday. But for me, I'm excited. It's the best day of the week for me. Wednesday night, the second best day. But some of that stuff that showed it come on Monday night or on Thursday or Friday, and I'm not trying to make you not look forward. We can't watch TV now at the church. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that for me to get addicted to something, it starts with me touching it, tasting it, smelling it, licking it, you know, experimenting with it. And these shows and this phone will take us there. Remember the conversation that Satan had with Eve in Galatians 3:1? Did God really say? Did Pastor really say that we can't? Did I ain't said that. I said, take heed lest you fall. I said, make sure you got a healthy balance. I said, don't get up and get on your phone and see who called you last night or who's doing what on Instagram before you open up your Daily Bread and see what God says or open up your Bible or go to a Psalm or a Proverbs or go to one of the Gospels and just get a word from God. That's what I said. But see, that won't be passed on. What'll be passed on? Pastor said, we don't need to be doing no social media. Well, what am I supposed to do? I didn't say that. Then the last one that'll let you know if you suffer from FOMO is if others express concern about your usage or you downplay it as if you're not acknowledging you're out of balance, and you're acting like they just don't want you, just don't want me to have fun. You on your phone playing games all the time. I ain't on my phone playing games all the time. I ain't out there killing nobody. How many of y'all have had people say, I've had people tell me I'm on my phone too much. I've had people tell me, here's the quote, you're always on your phone. I got to accept that. And let me help y'all understand. Honesty goes a long way in deliverance. It's rule number one in recovery. You got to admit you got a problem. Can I get a help from anybody who's been delivered from something? You acknowledge you had a problem first. It wasn't that you're on your phone a lot. It's that every time I see you, you're always on the phone. You know my response? Tell church folks stop calling me. You know what they should have said? Stop answering the phone every time they call you. You know what I'd have said? Stay out of my business. You see what I'm saying? You see what I'm saying? Because eventually, I'm going to justify my behavior that I'm always on the phone. So how do you resolve FOMO? What's FOMO, y'all? Fear of missing out. Engage with people that are or that you are with. Where's Brother Randolph? He here? I just want to apologize to him. Let me go down the list. I want to apologize to him. I want to apologize to my mama. I want to apologize to anybody I've ever met with. I won't ask for his phone because I threw his around the other day. Let me use your phone. Here are my meetings with people. Here are my meetings. Go on, man. I'm listening to you. Go on. I hear you. I know. You're right. See, because some of us can multitask real good. Can I get amen from a multitasker? You don't miss a word. You're not overlooking. You're not hearing. You're not sensitive. Because I'll know if he, you know, because I thought about killing myself. For real? You did? What happened then? And then minister and get him back on. You know, your life is worth living. Your life matters. God created you, and he didn't make any mistake. He didn't get you back on the same track. And then I'm back on my phone. Yeah, so then. For years. Am I telling the truth? For years, this is how I function. I ain't doing that no more. That don't mean I'm never not going to do it again. Because it's what I do every day for years. But what I'm going to stop doing is talking to people but looking at a machine. So if I'm going to resolve FOMO, I've got to look at people when I'm meeting with people, and I need to give people my full attention. I wish I could get some help up in here, boy. This is like a crack convention, amen. With 100 crack users that don't nobody want to get off crack. It'd be different. I'm with 100 folk that want to get off. They just need help. I'm with 100 crack users, maybe 125 crack users, and 2 want to get off. And 3 are going, I can't wait till he finished. What time is it? 8:28, 2 minutes, so I can go get some more crack. I'm going to tell y'all right now, I'm going to finish in 7 minutes, not 2. So if you're going to get high, you're going to get high in 7 minutes and not in 2. So the first thing you got to do is you got to have some eye contact with people. Look folk in the eye when you're talking to them. Can I get some help from somebody? Second, focus on creating a life of freedom. Romans 13:8 says to old man, nothing but focus on just being free. You ever forget your phone and then you wish you could get it, but you couldn't because you on BART on the way to work, but it ain't a bad day because you didn't trip on the phone, even though when you get home, you run to the phone. But that day, you were free. Remember before we had phones? Remember before you were inundated with emails and phones and text messages? Do y'all remember? Remember when you did miss out on some stuff because you couldn't be everywhere? Now everybody holds you accountable because, you know, I texted it to you. I emailed it to you. I didn't get it. I emailed it to your address. I got 3 addresses. You didn't check all of them? No, not today I didn't. Well, it's 8 a.m. I don't know how you didn't. Remember a time that you was like, I couldn't check it. I ain't got no computer. Mama, you check your email? No, I didn't check it. Mom, your email on your phone. I'm like telling her, just because she got a phone, that she has to be accessible, and she don't want to be accessible all the time. It's amazing how much you can learn from folk that are older than you. I wish I had some help in here. Let me give you this last couple. Observe a regular non-digital time. Matter of fact, let me go back. When we talk about focusing on creating a life of freedom, owe nobody anything but love. You ever see the most happiest people in the world? They probably don't, and it's not even they don't. The people that seem to be genuinely happy, they're not inundated with telephones. Whoever it is, you think of whoever it is you know that really enjoys life, I bet they don't spend tons of time on the phone. Think about it. I don't care who it is. It could be your grandmother. It could be your 11-year-old. Whoever seems to be happy with life, they're not masters to a phone. Or they're not caught up at the highest level in the digital age. Let me give you these last few. Observe regular non-digital times. There should be a time each day you're like, I'm putting my phone down. Message should change. Hi, I'm sorry you can't reach me right now. I will be answering calls between the hours of 12 and 2 and 6 and 8 p.m. If you call if you call any other time, leave me a message. But I'm only returning calls during that time. I guarantee you people won't say, where you been? I've been calling you. Because they're going to hear your message. And they won't ask you that. Then they'll stop calling you 8 times in a row. Like I didn't see your call the first 7 times. Y'all ain't walking with me. Don't raise your hand, but we do have some people in our lives that call you, you don't answer. They call you, you don't answer. They call you, you don't answer. They call you, you don't answer. Then when you answer, they be like, why didn't you answer the phone? I was contemplating killing myself because you was calling me so much, but observe regular non-digital times. Periods, whether it be full days, hours, or seasons where the phone doesn't have precedence. Think through the whys of what I'm missing out on. What are you missing out on if you ain't on your phone? It's just like going to France and not doing nothing but sleeping and eating in the hotel room. What are you missing out on? Everything. You can't make me believe we all been on our phones a whole lot. I'm on my phone. I'm really not missing out on anything. I'm not getting a whole lot. I'm getting drama. Getting a headache. Come on, somebody. If I step away from it, maybe I'm a little happier. Maybe life's a little more enriching. Maybe I appreciate the phone a little bit more because I'm not on it as much. Maybe now my phone stays downstairs. Mine does. When I come home, my phone goes downstairs. I sleep upstairs, and I don't get my phone until I get up in the morning. Some of y'all phone sleep closer than your husband. Something wrong. Train people in your life not to expect immediate responses from you. Last point. There's not much intimacy when you don't really know somebody. If you say, I love Pastor, if you don't really know, my brother loves me, I love him. He know me. Good, bad, and different. My sister loves me in spite of me. She knows me. But some of y'all can say, I love Pat. No, you don't. You don't know me. You can like me, but you don't know me enough to love me. Are y'all walking with me? Because real love is developed over time. And when John said, and you will know the truth, and the truth will release you, he said you'll have certainty and assurances of stuff you would not have had
if you did not know truth? And obviously, John was telling us that Christ is the way. And you will never know real truth if you don't know him. And you will never know him if you don't spend the time to get to know him. And these devices and the digital age is trying to draw you from the wonderful opportunity of getting to know God better and deeper and more intimate. Use the system inverted. The system wanted to draw you from God. Use them computers to draw closer to God. Download worship, download praise, download videos, download devotionals, download study material. Use it inverted for what it was meant for evil. Turn that thing around for the good. Last thing. Digital items keep us from getting closer to knowing him or anybody. When I'm talking to you, but I'm looking at my phone. Except this is true. Because we use the phones to hide behind a shield. I don't know how many of y'all have looked, but young kids can't even carry a conversation no more. I'm not throwing nobody under the bus. A little young lady called me today. She said she needed help with a project. I told her, call me later. She texted me and she said, I'm going to text you the questions. I couldn't believe it. So she's texting me the questions. And I'm going to talk to her after. But I just thought she was going to call me and ask the questions. She don't want to talk to me, really, because she don't know how. But she sure know how to text. I see my kids and friends, they be sitting at the thing, and I'm like, why ain't y'all talking? They like, we are talking. How y'all talking? We texting each other. What? They don't know how to talk. Y'all laughing, I'm serious as a heart attack. We have a generation of children that don't know how to communicate. But it doesn't matter if they want to. We're parents. We're supposed to be leading them in the way in which they shall go. We're killing our children. We're killing this generation. I don't care who made the phones. We buying the phones. We're not saying no. We're not saying put the phone down. We're helping to kill our kids. And in the Old Testament, when they had movies, it would be one actor playing multiple roles. It didn't start with Eddie Murphy and whatever the movie when he was the fat big mama. It didn't start with him. It didn't start with Richard Pryor, Which Way Is Up. They were in Old Testament times that they would just wear masks. And when they put one mask on, they were one character. And when they put another mask on, they were a different character. And all of those that were watching knew when you put the mask up, even though you did not change clothes, even though your tone may not have changed, they knew you were a different character because you changed faces. When we hide behind the phone, Sister Corinne, we change faces. Everybody tough behind phones. Everybody a thug behind phones. Everybody a player behind phones. Everybody's a baller behind phones. But the truth is, when you see them in real life, I see your Facebook pages, and I'm like, wow, she pretty. And then I see her in real life, and I'm like, wow. Y'all know I'm telling the truth? I'm like, wow. Because you put a face on behind the thing. Here it is, and I'm praying. Y'all ain't ready for me. Who really are you? I'm talking about when you ain't got your phone. Who really are you? Two more questions and I'm praying. Do you line up with who God has called you to be? If I haven't, I'm about to start. And then the last thing I want to say is, how can you change? Matthew 6:33 says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. He says, and everything else you need, everything else you want, everything else you desire, everything else you believe me for, he says, I'll add all the rest of that stuff. If you seek me, Isaiah 55:6, while I may be found, if you call on me, while I may be near. I'm telling y'all, I don't look for stuff. God just presents it to me.
I'm telling y'all, the next level that we're going to, God is telling us to remove these idols. He didn't say we can't enjoy a little of this or a little of that, but God is saying for me to do for y'all what I'm about to do for y'all, y'all got to do some stuff for me. And we got to put some stuff in place. And it is my prayer tonight that you know, faith comes by hearing. And that is a reiteration of hearing it over and over. I want you to listen to this again. Because obviously some of y'all are defensive and you don't feel I ain't on the phone that much. Yeah, you are. We all are. And we all can do better. And that's really all I'm asking you to do is consider the evidence and then ask yourself, does this phone have a stronghold on me? And would God be pleased with the amount of time I spend with him versus the amount of time I spend on these devices? To be honest, y'all, is it like this with the devices in you and God? Or is it like let's pray. Father, help us be honest with maybe some tough teaching and being honest with the control that technology has taken, not just over our lives, over the lives of this world. I mean, how far we've came that we're able to communicate with people 5,000 miles away. It's incredible. We can FaceTime and talk to people and do business deals and buy stuff, not have to leave our house, order food, not have to leave our house, buy groceries, not have to leave our house. It's incredible. We can go to work in our pajamas now because of technology. So all technology isn't bad. And we've learned to master technology, but we haven't learned to master our tongues. Jesus. So Lord, I'm just asking tonight that you would help us to look at the evidence. And I want everybody to put their hands on their hearts. And right now, I just want you to ask God, say, to create in me a clean heart. And say, and renew in me a steadfast spirit. I want to be right. And then put your hands on your mind. And I want you to declare this. Say, let that mind that be in Christ also be in me, in Jesus' name. Come on, somebody, thank God in advance for what he's going to do.
Praise the Lord, everybody. You know, one thing Pastor didn't mention, this right here, it's a phone too, right? Got it on my wrist. Shame on me. Amen. I got watches in the drawer, nice watches, but I choose to wear this because guess what? I'm addicted to the phone. So, amen, this Apple Watch, it's a nice watch. I didn't buy it, I won it, but still, I'm wearing it. And guess what? Texts come on it, emails. I don't play games on this, it's a little too small for that, but I can answer the phone, I can respond to texts. So it's not only a phone. Amen. I'm here to welcome our first-time guests. Amen. Do we have anybody here for the very first time worshiping with us on tonight? Nobody here for the first time? Well, amen. We're all family. We have some announcements. I would ask that you stay for the announcements because those of you that run off right away are always the ones that ask what's going on. So please stay and listen to the announcements. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Everybody say praise the Lord. Amen. I am Elder Demetrius Wallace, the Director of Education here at Grace Bible Fellowship. And, hallelujah. And as you know, I'm here to present to let you guys know that starting in January, on January the 8th, we are from January through March, we are going to be having life classes. Life classes are breakout classes. We got many subjects. If you look at the flyer, we have many different classes that you can sign up for. And this is most important, especially for you. Why? Because you're here at Bible study. You're here on Wednesday night. So all of you have to, all of us need to be signed up for a class, right? Sooner than later. Why sooner? Because I need to order material before Christmas. It means that I need you guys to sign up, and I need you to also pay the donation that we're asking for. It's $10 per person, $20, $25 per family. If there's a, you know, financial issue, just let us know. But I need everybody to sign up, because if you walk in here on two things, and I'm done. One, if you walk in here on January and you're not signed up, you're gonna walk into class, you're not gonna have any material. Right. And I'm not gonna order any material after Christmas. Amen? Because it's just, it doesn't make sense. We have to reorder stuff and we have to pay for shipping over and over again. Amen? So, Gina, stand up. Gina and I will be in the lobby. We'll be doing signups right after we close out. Amen.
Good evening. Real quick, I'm coming in behalf of Grace Closet, the Christmas winter coat and grocery giveaway. We are asking for donations. This is such an awesome time to give. We're asking for coats and beanies and scarves and gloves. We want to keep ourselves and community really warm this year. So by the 18th, if you would utilize those bins outside or the times that Grace Closet is open, which is twice a week, Wednesday 4 to 6, Saturday from 12 to 2, come on in, sign up for some clothes and get some free food. It's a free food and clothing pantry. It's about giving. It's about receiving. If you need, come and get. If you have, if you're living in the overflow, please come and give. Amen? Praise the Lord. Amen.
Good evening, Grace. I'm here on behalf of the staff, Sister Tony and I. I'm going to announce the first part of the gift, which is the children's toys that we'll be collecting out in the bins. You'll see the bin out in the foyer area. Please bring gifts for all ages, maybe gift cards for the teenagers, and then you could give that to a staff member if you're bringing gift cards. But let's fill up that bin. And then we're gonna have the adopt a family. This week we are having the adopt it, put in their needs. We have the cards out there. Sign up with three wishes and put them in the box, and we will match you with the sponsors who will be signing up next week. Okay, so let's fill those needs. Let's have this season be joyful for everyone.
Grace will be having our annual Christmas breakfast and gift giveaway on Christmas Day from 9 to 11 a.m. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. I'm coming on behalf of the music ministry. We are hosting our first annual voice and music workshop. We're asking that if you have a desire to sing, you sing in a choir somewhere before, you sing in a shower and you think you sound good, you beat on the table because you like to play the bongos like me. I make a mad beat on the table, y'all. But if you guys are interested in learning more, we're going to be doing vocal training, learning how to breathe, different things like that. I know I'm excited about learning some of these techniques. I've sung for a long time, but I've never learned how to sing. So I'm inviting everyone to come out on the 19th, 7 to 9, right here in the sanctuary. The musicians will be practicing and learning also here on that same night from 7 to 9. So we'll be taking names and getting your email information so that we can keep you abreast of what's going on. You can see me or Sister Susan here. Raise your hand, ma'am. Amen. Praise the Lord. You so funny. Amen.
Let us stand. Let us stand if we go down from this place. Do want to mention this coming Saturday morning, 9 a.m., is our Dream Vision strategic planning meeting kickoff. If you want to help us in building the next phase, that bowling alley, gymnasium, daycare center, et cetera, be here at 9 o'clock sharp. We'll meet 9 to, I don't think it'll go to 10, but we'll have our initial meeting this week. So if you just want to come, it'll be here. If you want to come and just see what we're talking about, just imagine building anything, everything you need to build. So if you do anything, if you decorate, you know, if you're good in administration or whatever the case may be, you build stuff, you're good with numbers, whatever the case may be, we need you. So prayerfully consider being here at 9 o'clock on Saturday. Thank you.
Amen. Our final benediction, scripture first, man does not live by cell phone alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of the Lord. Amen. May the grace of God and the sweet communion of his Holy Spirit continue to rest, rule, and abide in each and every one of you, your families, your friends, and your loved ones. Henceforth and forevermore, you are dismissed. Amen.